Hello, it's Carly McAvoy. Today I'm talking about factoring trinomials, and we're going to use the box method to do this. For some of you who struggled with trinomials before, you might find this really helpful. For those of you that have never struggled with it and you don't have any problems with the other methods that you've seen, then there's no reason to watch this video. This is for people who kind of don't do well with the factoring trinomials. It's a trinomial because there's three terms. In the box method, you're going to draw a box, make four parts inside, and make a line that sticks out to the side. Over the first column goes your first term, in this case x squared. Over the last column goes the last term, in this case 4, and I'm going to put the plus in front of it because the signs are important. And down below, under this little piece that sticks out, goes our middle term, plus 5x. Certainly for these early ones, you might not need to use the box method, but if you learn the method, then you can use it on the more difficult problems. So in this case, I'm going to say everything under that first column has to equal x squared. So I'm going to put x and x. I'm using a pencil in case I make a mistake, but that should be pretty straightforward. And then I have to put two things that multiply to be 4. Let's say I did 2 times 2. The next thing I do is multiply straight across. I get 2x and 2x. These two terms have to add up to 5x. So obviously, the 2 and 2 are not a good choice. What else could I use for 4? Well, the other thing you can put under 4 would be 1 and 4. So now if I multiply across, I get 1x and 4x, and that would add up to 5x. Your answer to this is always on the diagonal. So we have x and 1, that means x plus 1, and then x and 4, and that means x plus 4. Notice that there's no negative signs in this problem at all. There's no negative signs in our answer. Our answer, if we wanted to check that, we would FOIL it. We would multiply the first two, x times x is x squared. We'd multiply the outside, we'd get 4x. The inside, we'd get 1x. And the last, and we would get 4. And you can see that we get those 4 parts as we FOIL that. That's what the box method is, just another way to look at the FOIL. And then that answer is the sum of those two parts. Feel free to try any of these by shutting your video off and trying them without me. That's always a good practice. Okay, I'm going to draw my box. Over the first column goes p squared. Over the last column goes my last term. And down the bottom is my negative 7p. So I know that p squared is going to be p and p, because that's the only thing it can be. And then I'm going to try to find two things that multiply to be 12, and I'm wanting them to add up to 7. So if you look at the factors of 12, you have 1 and 12, 2 and 6, 3 and 4. Which ones make sense for our problem? Well, 3 and 4 make sense for our problem. But if I multiply straight across, I get 3p and 4p, and that would add up to 7p, and I need negative. Which one of these should I make negative? Well, what you should notice is that I need both of these to be negative to get negative 7p. Therefore, I have a negative 3 and a negative 4. Does that make sense? Yes, because negative 3 times negative 4 is positive 12, and p times p is p squared. And negative 3p and negative 4p add up to negative 7p. I feel confident this is my answer. Off the diagonal, I have p negative 3, or p minus 3, and p minus 4. To check that, p squared, negative 4p, negative 3p, and positive 12. And these two terms add up to negative 7p, which is what I want to get. Okay, let's look at another one. I've got negative here and a negative there. I want to make sure when I write my box that I put all the negatives in. It doesn't take long to get good at this method. I've been teaching this method for many years, and people that struggle with factoring otherwise find it easy to use. Again, some people don't struggle with factoring. In that case, there's no point in using this method. 14 is 1 times 14, and it's also 2 times 7. it makes sense to me that we're going to be using 2 and 7. This is the factorization for that, because we want to get to 5, and 1 and 14 wouldn't do it. So I have y and y, and then here I have 2 and 7. Notice that I have a negative 14, so one of these has to be negative. If I multiply across, I get 2y and 7y. Which one of those should be negative, so that when I add these up, I get negative 5? The 7 needs to be negative, so I need to put a negative here. Important point, you never put a negative in the first column. There should never be a negative for your lead term. So it's always important, if there's a negative, it has to be in that second column. Multiplying across, I get 2y and negative 7y, which adds up to negative 5y. Notice that 2 and negative 7 multiply to negative 14. So I'm convinced that's my answer. I have y plus 2 and y minus 7. It does not matter which one of these you put first. That's just the commutative law, right? You can change the order of things being multiplied. And so it doesn't matter if you put the negative 7 up here and the 2 down there. What does matter is that the negative is with the 7, because that's the only way we're going to get a negative 5, and the positive is with the 2, but the order of the parentheses are not important. Okay, finally we have this one. This is where some people like to do another method, but when you get big numbers, sometimes it can be a bit of a pain to find those factors that work. So this is going to be n squared. This is negative 108, and this is 3n. Again, it comes in handy if you know your factors of big numbers like that, but most people don't. Take a minute to write them down. So I know 1 goes in there, so I have 1 and 108. That's never going to get me to 3. I have 2 and 54. That wouldn't work. 3 goes in here as well. 3 goes in, how many times goes in here? 3, 18, 36. No. 4 goes in this as well. It goes in here 2, and then 7. Still no help. 5 doesn't go because it doesn't end in a 5 or a 0. 6 does go because 2 and 3 go. 6 goes in here once in 18. Of course, you can use your calculator to find these. That would be nice. 7 does not go evenly in. 8 does. 8 goes in here, doesn't it? Goes once, and then 28. No, it doesn't. What about 9? 9 goes in there 12 times. 9 and 12. I could get to 3 using 9 and 12. So that was a pain, but we did it. You could use a calculator to go a little faster on that. I need one of those to be negative. If I multiply across, I get 9n and 12n. Which one of those should be negative? Because I want it to be a positive 3n. I want the greater number to be positive. So I'm going to make this negative, which means the 9 is negative. I never put a negative there. So I have n minus 9 and n plus 12. And then I can check that. It's n squared. That's negative 108. Negative 9n and positive 12n add up to positive 3n. So I have done that correctly. Now, there's some questions that I'm saying try on your own. I'm saying try these on your own because if you don't try this method with these easier ones, it's very likely when you get to the harder ones, you're going to make a mistake. So what I would ask you to do is to pause it, try the problems, and then come back. And for those of you that are just sitting here watching, at least try to work ahead of me a little bit. So why I wanted you to do these, because 36 is tricky. People sometimes forget that when you're working with 36, they do 6 times 6. But don't forget, we also have, this is f squared, this is 36, this is negative 13f. This is f and f, obviously. 36 could be a lot of different things, but we know for sure that it has to add up to 13. And the only pair that you found when you were doing that, hopefully, was 4 and 9. And those two would both be negative because we want negative 4f and negative 9f to add up to negative 13f. And so the answer you should have gotten off the diagonal, which that becomes very important as we move into the next video. So you always have to take that off the diagonal. I always put them in there just to remind you that that's coming off of that. And that would be f squared, and negative 9 and negative 4 would be negative 13f, and then positive 36. I put this one in here because people get confused because 5 could be 6 and 1, or it could be 2 and 3, right? So this is one that people miss a lot because they just don't pay attention to the signs. So hopefully you did not make that mistake when you worked it offline as I asked you to. Okay, so there it is. So what some people will do is say, oh, 5 could be 1 and 6. Well, I'm going to use my pencil here. If I put 1 and 6 in here, I get 1x and 6x. Now, if I want to get to negative 5x, that would have to be negative. And if I put the negative in here, 1 times negative 6 does not equal positive 6. So you have to really be careful with the sign. Sometimes the sign alone is what's going to indicate that you made a mistake. What should I have done? Well, if I did 2 and 3, I would get 2x and 3x. And if both of those were negative, I could get 5x. So in fact, it's negative negative, and those two negatives make that positive 6, giving me an answer of x minus 2 and x minus 3. And finally, this one, it's no different than some of the others. It's just that it's got an x and a y, and that throws people a little bit. I'm going to put it, remember the box method works for any trinomial. So if it's a trinomial, you can use it. X squared, positive 5y squared, and down below 6xy. Well, x squared is x and x. And I also made this pretty easy because 5 can only be 5 times 1. So I would say 1y and 5y. Now if I multiply across, I get xy and 5xy. Does that add up to be 6xy? It does. And this is 5y squared, and this is x squared. So my answer off the diagonal is x plus y and x plus 5y. So you can have two variables in there. That's not a problem. The next one we do is going to be some harder stuff, so tune back in.